Elk seizoen maken we een selectie uit de aankondigingen van nieuw werk van zowel binnen- als buitenlandse kunstenaars. We gieten elke aankondiging in een beeld. Al die beelden samen worden een boek. Met dat boek trokken we maanden geleden naar de kunstenaars van wie nieuw werk in het boek wordt aangekondigd. We troffen hen aan in volle voorbereiding en vroegen hen welk werk van welke collega's hen intrigeert. De Canvasconnectie. Vandaag met Lee Ranaldo. Lee Ranaldo is een Amerikaans muzikant. Begin jaren 80 richtte hij samen met Kim Gordon en Thurston Moore de rockband Sonic Youth op. Sonic Youth wordt beschouwd als een van de meest invloedrijke hedendaagse bands. Voor hun iconische album Hoeze werkten ze samen met beeldende kunstenaars als Gerard Richter en Jeff Wall. Nu Sonic Youth voor onbepaalde tijd op non-actief staat, stort Lee Ranaldo zich op andere projecten. Amper een jaar na de release van zijn eerste soloalbum werkt hij alweer aan nieuw materiaal. We zochten hem op in New York, waar hij werkt en woont.
Ja. Okay. Let me see if I can find the record immediately here. This is it.
My first record. Yeah, the artwork is just a couple blocks from here. It was just fortuitous. I was walking by this site on my way to do an interview. Just the photographer casually snapped a couple shots. And when I saw them, I saw this shot and I thought it just looked like an album cover. I wasn't still clear at that moment that I was going to be making an album or not, but as soon as I saw it, I thought, wow, it looks so much like an album cover, I'd better make the record that goes with it. I think I've started almost every song on both of my records now on this absolutely cheap guitar, like the cheapest guitar you can find, practically. Usually when I start playing a guitar, I just start tuning till something happens. You're just changing the... Usually if you just start playing around, you're kind of in a voyage of discovery at that point. You put your fingers down and hear what it sounds like and see what happens. You know, these instruments have such a character to them. You don't need to plug anything in or have an amplifier that, you know, the neighbors will complain about.
Caught myself standing in our door today. Wondering how the time has flown.
Initially, I was working on acoustic guitars, and I thought I was just going to make a record that was just solo voice and acoustic guitar. It turned into much more of a band record and has become a band project at this point.
Let's turn off all the lights now. Turn on the stars. Kick all the windows open wide. I hear a sweet guitar.
Okay, I've got it. It's gigantic. Or maybe. Okay, so yeah, it's massive. When I see the ones I want to talk about, I'm just taking them instead of having to go back and. I pulled a couple pages. Oh, now I'm really going to pull them out of order. I really have fucked you up here with this. I'm going to mess up everything. But television. We're one of the most important bands from that late 70s New York punk and no wave and new wave music. The first record in particular, I guess, is their main calling card, Marquee Moon. I'm sure I have some of the music on the computer. And that might be it. I'll go grab the cover. You know, we would listen to those records before we moved to New York, and they represented a certain dimension into what was going on here. There was no describing how new and vital the music sounded. Felt like it was tapping into all kinds of influences. Tom Verlaine, the lead singer and main writer, talks about bringing free jazz together with this kind of a punk do-it-yourself ethos. With, you know, a love for the kind of AM radio rock and roll music that we all grew up on. And synthesizing it all together in such a unique way. I think that the picture they used on the cover was actually a color Xerox of a color photo. So it has a very strange cast to the light of it. And yeah, Verlaine's face especially is very, very gaunt around the cheeks. You would see these pictures and just wonder what kind of people you would find living in New York. It was just an incredible time. There was all this amazing music happening in the clubs, like places like Naxos, Kansas City. And CBGBs in the 70s. You know, the scene has kind of become legend to some degree. And it led to the whole rise of everything that caused people like myself and Thurston and Kim to move to New York and start Sonic Youth. Well, I had this page pulled aside of Mike Kelly. He's someone that I think of as being one of the most important artists of the last 50 years or so. You know, he did installations, he did sculpture, he did more traditional painting, he did plays and environments and theater pieces. In the early 90s, we used his work that showed these stuffed animals. He started building these tableaus with these stained rugs he'd find in thrift stores with these animals set up on them. So we used a series of those animals that he photographed for the cover of our Dirty record. This is what the cover of that Dirty record looks like by Mike Kelly. This is just somebody's copy of that doll. I think there was something about the fact that at one point, you know, this was something that a child loved and then later discarded that, that he was fascinated by, and maybe it said something about his own upbringing or his own youth or something like that. Like in the early days of Sonic Youth, he was doing a performance piece. He asked us if we would be on stage as the band providing a live soundtrack. Mike is the guy dressed up with the bra on, and he's beating on somebody else, and that's me and Steve and Kim and Thurston in the background.
I'm all the way from California.
It was mostly Mike talking and walking around on the stage and interacting in little weird ways. It was kind of almost Dadaist.
Take a good thing when it comes and quit trying to...
He was always drawing from his own personal experiences as a young, sort of awkward, teenager growing up.
Gift of oranges.
But, you know, he tragically killed himself earlier last year, and I'd been talking to Mike a lot in the year before he died, and I was, as so many people were, completely shocked. Teacup. Her name is Teacup. This is Teacup. When she was born, she could fit in a teacup. She doesn't like to sit on the lap. She just likes to be nearby. But let's see. Oh, here. Where did you get this picture? Oh, my God. I mean, it doesn't show Raymond's work. That is so funny, because I've played baseball in his studio with him. It's crazy. You know, hitting away from the windows, obviously, but occasionally some glass does get broken, I have to say. He's a big baseball fan. He has a lot of pictures of baseball players in particular.
But
he got his start doing posters and flyers for the California hardcore band Black Flag.
I'm about to have a nervous breakdown. My head really hurts. If I don't find a way out of here, I'm gonna go to Circus.
He also would do these folded and stapled Xerox fanzines. They were sold at Black Flag shows. Basically, his style was fully formed at that point. I mean, it was, you know, these are very, very early, and it's all here. You know, I mean, I think in a way, Black Flag kind of circles back to being a very early influence on Sonic Youth.
When the sea of madness turns me into stone, a picture of your life shines like me.
This was the picture, that's funny that I turned to that one, we originally wanted to use on the cover of Goo. And it was called Blowjob. And we wanted that to be the cover of our very first major label album, and the record company totally freaked out. They were like, we can't do it. It's like, what, are you kidding us? And in a way, it's a pity we didn't use it in some form. It would have been nice. The Goo cover looks like that. It says, I stole my sister's boyfriend. It was all whirlwind heat and flash. Within a week, we killed my parents and hit the road. You know, his work is very text-based as well as visual. In the early 80s, I sent him a bunch of writings I did, and he took some words out of those writings and added them to some of his drawings that he was doing. So the one on the wall over here shows kind of a, looks like a cadaver, like a hippie, a dead hippie or something. It says, they talk like they play guitar. Did you get a confession then? I'm not sure, I guess we did. We rapped all night. And under that he wrote fuzz tone in a different kind of typeface. And that came from one of the pieces I had sent to him. Robert Smithson. He's an artist that I constantly go back to for inspiration in terms of the things that he did. And he made a famous artwork called The Spiral Jetty. There's a picture of The Spiral Jetty on the cover of this work here. He was what they called an earth artist. I did a musical work dedicated to him. He made a lot of works in the 70s. He died in the 70s. He died in a helicopter crash photographing one of his works. First of all, there's a picture of Smithson himself. We have a piece of his. It's up on the wall there. It's called Torn Photograph. It's a photograph of some rubble that he tore into quarters. It was a multiple. It was a print. And I'm sometimes printmaker, and so I subsequently made a work of my own that was in homage to that work. I might have a picture of it, but this building that we live in until not too long ago was also the building that the composer Steve Reich lived in. That was a big deal to me because his work was an early inspiration to me, and in particular, Steve created this piece called Four Organs. It's a half an hour long work where not very much happens, but a very slow, minimal evolution happens. When I first moved into this building, I was prowling around in the basement, and sure enough, the four organs of this legendary piece were just stacked in our basement, gathering dust. And so I took some pictures of those organs, and with Steve's blessing, I made a work that was in tribute to both him and to Smithson. It's in the exact format of the Smithson piece, and it's torn in quarters like the Smithson piece. The final part of the story is that when Steve moved out of the building, he gave me the organs. So they're in my studio now. So they're still they still have life. We found a space in Hoboken, New Jersey, which is just across the river. Sonic Youth made our last two records there. And I made my two records there as well. My band is now called Lee Ranaldo and the Dust. It's Steve Shelley from Sonic Youth playing drums. It's nice to have a good old friend in the band. Another good friend of mine, Alan Licht, is on second guitar. He's a really good guitar player. He was one of the first guys I asked to help me out. So maybe I should just go in there and throw down a vocal on this and then we can mix it. When we were in the studio yesterday, we were mixing takes of this one song called The Rising Tide.
The rising tide has kept us dry and high.
The song is basically about this boat that used to sit in the back of my friend's yard in the off season, you know, just wedged in amongst the trees most of the year.
It's leafy green and the sunlight is tracing your eyes.
It was like a little hideaway when we were teenagers, and we used to climb up into the boat to drink beer or, you know, whatever.
Valerie said it might be strong, so we'd all see the light, so it would last so long.
It's one of these songs that has a more psychedelic feel to it. And so we have a lot of versions of it that each have a different improvisational middle going on, where we can get into different emotional territory with the music. I mean, like, this part instrumentally feels pretty damn good. Yeah. You know, we're not trying to make pop songs out of them or anything like that. We're trying to make an interesting musical experience out of them. I gotta listen through this shit and get some of these riffs down so I can play this song. With all the elements in place and all the words in place, it's time for us to learn how to go out and reproduce it live. You can turn it back down if you want, Ted. I think it's pretty good. This is coffee that came from Brazil. I was just in Brazil with my band. A guy came up to me in Brazil, said that it came from his grandfather's plantation, but they kept the best stuff for themselves. And he gave me a couple bags full of it. So instead of using the espresso machine, we're making more traditional drip coffee. Let's see what else you've got in here. I mean, there's so much. There's no Godard picture in here. There's nothing about Jean-Luc Godard in here. He's big for me. Yeah, I've got another shelf full of his stuff. He's in his 80s now, and he's also continuing to make challenging and interesting films. I studied painting at university, and they had a little avant-garde film department. I'm sure that that was where I saw Breathless for the first time.
Bonsoir.
The film basically centers around two people, and one is Jean-Paul Belmondo, and the other is Jean Seabrook. At her most beautiful, with a short haircut. She's got this kind of Parisian striped dress, and she plays an American in Paris who gets mixed up with this mobster. They have some adventures, some sweet romance before he dies in the end. You know, the plot of the film is not that important. You know, it was a very low-budget film. It was shot on 16-millimeter film, I think, and they didn't have the money to have sync sound, so all of the sound in the whole film is added later.
Ton sourire, quand on le voit de profil, c'est ce que tu as de mieux. Ça, c'est toi.
C'est moi.
The thing that was incredible about his films is a lot of them had very limited means, and it never impacted how strongly the films affected you. I mean, he always had a notion of something that he was trying to say, and just the way he said it was just not typical of any other filmmaker. For instance, he used this jump cut style.
J'aime une fille qui a une très jolie nuque, de très jolis seins, une très jolie voix, de très jolis poignets, un très joli front, de très jolis genoux.
It just cuts in this kind of radical manner that, you know, has kind of become incorporated into the general language of filming, but I think that people were disoriented by it.
C'est pour ça que tu disais jouer quitte au double tout à l'heure?
Oui, un peu pour ça.
Allons voir le western au Napoléon.
Oui, ou mieux attendre que la nuit tombe.
And now if you see that film, you say, well, what's so special about this? And it's because the language it invented has become immediately incorporated into just about every film made.
Méfie-toi, Jessica. Les bisous, les baisers, les gens passent trop vite. Et vite, et vite, et vite, les souvenirs brisés.
So, yeah, I mean, you definitely need to put a page of Jean-Luc Godard in this book. Okay, all right, so this... maybe I should go to this now, because this is kind of important. This picture you have of Donald Judd. You know, he's an early minimalist living in New York. He made a lot of big pieces. They looked like just big aluminum boxes. They were very important in that period. He established an outpost for himself down in Texas in a place called Marfa. He bought an old Air Force base down there. He wanted his work to exist in an environment that he completely controlled. He controlled how it looked, how it was lit. But he found he was never quite satisfied with the furniture. And so he started to design his own. Now, this book I have to be very careful with. It's kind of quite a rare piece, I guess. Oh God, it's all taped up. Let's see if I can find some good pictures. His furniture has a great relationship to his artwork, but it had a different bent to it in that it was meant to be functional. There's a famous chair by the Dutchman Rietveld. It's a zigzag chair. I know that he was inspired by the simplicity of that chair. He ended up building all of his own furniture, and it was a testament to him as a control freak, but it was also someone who knew the environment he wanted to exist in. So he managed to make it happen. I like the art, but the furniture never ceases to amaze me somehow. There's just something so beautiful about it. Before anything happens to this book, I'm gonna put it away. Hey, Lee, let me hand you the Judd book just so nothing untoward happens to it. One thing I've been doing recently, and it's about keeping from being bored on tour, I've been doing a lot of drawings in the van as we drive around, and I've been making quick sketch drawings in the front seat of the van, not driving, of course, just sitting in the front passenger seat of the van and sketching the road as it's moving by and trying to capture something of the motion of it or the landscape of it. Sometimes they get very abstract, but trying to capture a certain kind of iconography of a highway. It's something I've been doing on and off for 20 or 30 years or more. I've kind of been working on them a little bit more seriously now. Well, I have a gallery in Belgium, and I'm gonna have a show there in the spring where I show a lot of these. So yeah, so they're coming along. Now I was trying to find this Brazilian graffiti. I know it's in here. Here it is. So anyway, it says Street Art Brazil. I was just in Brazil and we spent a lot of time in São Paulo, and there's a form of street art there that I'm really, really involved with. And it's called pichação. It's a kind of graffiti writing that is very particular to Sao Paulo. It's kind of what it looks like. It's these long, elongated letters that almost look like Egyptian hieroglyphic. And the kids down there bomb these buildings. And they climb the outside like Spider-Man. They don't have ropes or anything like that. They just, you know, have a bag of spray cans over their shoulder. But some of them are incredibly beautiful. You know, sometimes it's political messages. Sometimes it's people's names or their tags, like the way New York style graffitius would have done in the 70s. But anyway, during one of the gigs in Sao Paulo, I met a guy who was a Pichação graffiti writer, and I got him to do the name of my band for a possible T-shirt in this style. So the band is called Lee Ranaldo and the Dust. That was very fortuitous, because I've been just digging this, the way this stuff looks graphically for so long. And let me grab a few other things to talk about here. This one. Just give me a second to pull some reference stuff out. This is like a test sheet for my new record. Last Night on Earth, it's called, you know, this is a gatefold record, so it'll be folded like that, and then you'll open it up and you'll see the picture of the band. But I've got fisheye photos on the front and back cover of the record. Just, you know, there's a lot of records that were done with covers like that. There's a famous one by the Byrds. Captain Beefheart did one. The back cover of an early Grateful Dead record has a fisheye photo. They should have a page in your book, too. I've been listening to a lot of their music recently because my new record has taken a bit of a psychedelic turn. I've recently been re-listening to a lot of their early records where they did long, extended jams that kind of relate to the music I'm making right now and also the music that Sonic Youth made at one point or another during our career. Just because there's a lot more free playing on my new record than on the first one that we were talking about earlier. This one has a lot more group playing where, you know, it's a little bit more improvisational. I like that word better than jammy, but it's a little bit more musical in a way.